Graydon House and Harper Audio present Miss del Río, a novel by Bárbara Mujica, performed by Frankie Corzo. To my husband Mauro and my children, Lily, Mariana, and Mauro III. Prologue. Los Angeles, April 11th, 1988. I can hardly believe she's gone. She died on April 11th, 1983, exactly 5 years ago. I lit a candle and said a prayer, but I wasn't able to lay a bouquet on her grave. She's buried in the Panteón de Dolores in the Rotonda de las Personas Ilustres in Mexico City. And I can no longer travel. I'm too old. Arthritis has stiffened my legs and fingers, and I just can't handle the hustle and bustle of the airport. To the world, she was Dolores del Río, Hollywood star and first lady of the golden age of Mexican cinema. She was Mexico's first international female film personality, a celebrity on three continents. She was the embodiment of beauty, glamour, and elegance. To me, she was Lola, my best friend. It seems like yesterday we were little girls exchanging secrets under the aguahuete tree in Don Francisco's garden. And then, unexpectedly, we both found ourselves in Los Angeles, where Lola was launching her career in the movies, and I was twisting ladies' hair into Marcel curls at Marie's beauty salon. Lola was the daughter of a wealthy banker, and I was the daughter of a maid, but we were like sisters. After Lola died, a customer at Marie's suggested I write down her story. "You knew her better than anyone," she said. "You're the one who should do it." I tried. I was good at English in school, so I didn't think it would be that hard. But I'm a hairdresser, not a writer. I struggled to find the right words, and gripping a pen for hours on end made my fingers ache. Now, though, I see that I don't have much time left. I'm approaching the end. Maybe, before long, Lola and I will be exchanging secrets in heaven, if you believe in that sort of thing. Anyhow, if I'm ever going to finish this memoir, or chronicle, or whatever you want to call it, I have to get to work, even if it hurts my fingers. After all, working through the pain is something I learned from Lola. Part 1. 1. Durango, 1910. Escape. Lola crouched beside the armoire the way her mother had told her. Something was going on. Something awful. Everyone looked terrified. Even Mama, usually so regal and poised in her bustled skirts and lacy, tight-sleeved blouses, was tense and angry. Nearly all the maids had disappeared. Where were they? Only Juana, loyal Juana, had stayed behind to care for her. But now there was so much work to do that Juana couldn't spend the whole day in the nursery. She had to take over the kitchen and do the jobs of the laundress and the parlor maid and the chambermaid, too. There was no one around to sweep Mama's hair up into a bird's nest. And the strange thing was that Mama didn't seem to care. She pinned up her thick brown mane herself without fussing when a whole lock came loose and fell defiantly over her shoulder. Lola began to whimper. "Chachita," hissed Doña Antonia. "I told you to be quiet. Don't make a sound. It's dangerous." She tiptoed across the bedroom where they were hiding and squatted beside Lola.
"Mamo, I have to pee."
"You can't pee now. You have to be very, very still. They can't know we're here. And don't call me Mamo. You're going to get us killed."
"But Mommy, I have to pee."
Doña Antonia crawled toward the bed, grabbed the chamber pot from underneath, and dragged it back behind the armoire. "There, go ahead." 6-year-old Lola picked up her dress and pulled down her bloomers, When she was done, Doña Antonia pushed the pot away.
I can't empty it now, she whispered. Just leave it there.
Lola bit her lip. She knew better than to ask again what was going on. The tightness of her mother's jaw, the way she rubbed her hands against her long black silk skirt, her hushed voice and edgy gaze. All these things told Lola that from now on, she would have to sniff back her tears and not ask questions. Things had begun to change months ago. Now she could no longer tear through the patio with Juana, screeching with laughter while her dog, Sirico, yapped happily. She was no longer free to dance for hours to the music of the Victrola. She could not ride out to the country house in the landau with Mama and Papa, or trot around the orchard on her milk-white pony. She had to stay where she was, be very still, and creep around on all fours like a baby so that nobody would know they were hiding in their own house.
How long do we have to stay here? Whispered Lola.
She was tired of crouching by the armoire. The air reeked of piss, and the heat was stifling.
I think they've gone. I'll send Juana out to the patio to check. Who's gone, Mommy? I thought I heard a noise, but let's see what Juana says. If she says it's clear, you can play, but stay indoors and away from the windows. Holy Virgin, this is a nightmare.
A moment later, Juana entered the bedroom and assured them that no one was in the patio or at the stables, and the doors were all secure. Lola sprang up, but Doña Antonia held onto her ankle.
Wait, she whispered. She still looked worried.
Lola squirmed.
Why? Juana says it's all right.
Doña Antonia sighed. She looked wistful, but after a moment she said,
All right, go play.
Lola had noticed that lately the grown-ups had been speaking in muffled voices. Her parents thought that Lola wasn't listening, but she was. They tried to shield her from the truth, but they couldn't. There had been stories about people just like them, the Asunsolo López Negrete family. Decent people who shared their idyllic existence in beautiful Durango, a city filled with elegant colonial-style homes and wide streets upon which stylish carriages rolled day and night. A city that boasted a 17th-century Baroque cathedral considered the jewel of northern Mexico. Decent people who came to her mother's soirees, the men in top hats and tails, white boutonnieres in their lapels, the women in frilly high-collared blouses. People whose children were learning French and believed Porfirio Diaz had saved Mexico from barbarism and superstition. Stories, for example, like what had happened the month before to the Perez Lorenzo baby. She had pieced it together from scraps of speech and muffled sobs behind closed doors. Pablito had been playing in his room, attended by his niñera. Lola had seen the child often, a roly-poly two-year-old with soft brown curls and rosy cheeks, the spitting image of his father. His mother, Doña Mercedes, gave him a kiss and told the nursemaid to put him down for a nap. The weather was lovely, temperate and dry, and she had instructed the servants to set up tables outside on the veranda for her weekly card game. But the tables weren't there. The potted dahlias she had ordered the kitchen girls to place on each one, still sitting in rows in the patio. Fuchsia, crimson, orange, and yellow blooms opening to the sunlight like tiny origami forms. Doña Mercedes glanced at her watch. The ladies would arrive soon. She breathed deeply and listened. Silence. Suddenly, she felt her blood turn to ice. She spun around, darted up the stairs, and ran to the nursery. A scream of terror froze in her throat. The nursemaid had vanished. A ladder rested against the unbolted window. Pablito was propped up in his little chair, his head thrown back, his mouth and eyes wide open. Someone had arranged the scene to produce maximum horror when his mother found him sitting there, his throat slit from ear to ear. Lola understood what had happened, but why did it happen? Could it happen to her? After the tragedy at the Perez Lorenzo estate, her mother became increasingly anxious and angry. She stopped being meticulous about her dress and hair. She sent Sirocco to the country to be cared for by a farm family. Often, she and Lola's father, Don Jesus Leonardo, locked themselves in the study for hours, leaving Lola to fend for herself or hang onto Juana's skirts while the maid ironed in the laundry room. Lola was bored, and she missed her dog. But after a week or so, she began to lose her fear. She had heard of no other murders of children. Besides, she knew that Juana would never abandon her the way Pablito's niñera had abandoned him. Juana had come to work for the Asunzulos as a 10-year-old and had lived with the family her whole life. She'd been taking care of Lola since she was born. She wouldn't just disappear through an open window. Anyway, her parents were dead. Where would she go? Sometimes, Lola snuck away from the nursemaid and pressed her ear against the study door. She heard words like cash, accounts, liquidate, but she knew that her father had a high position at the Bank of Durango, so these were the kinds of words he always used. Then one day there were new words, words she hadn't heard before. Pancho Villa. Lola didn't dare ask her mother what these words meant, so she ran to Juana. Oh, Pancho Villa is a very famous man, explained the maid nonchalantly. His real name is Doroteo Arango. He shot a man to protect his sister's honor. Right there in Rancho El Gorgojito, one of your father's properties. Your father is a very rich man, you know, señorita. Anyhow, now Pancho Villa has become a protector of the people. Protector of the people? What does that mean? Nothing you need to know about, little one. Now go and play. Do you want me to turn on the Victrola so you can dance? Only don't dance near the window. It's too dangerous. Juana stroked Lola's cheeks and dug into the pocket of her apron. She pulled out a brightly colored candy and handed it to her. Don't tell your mommy, she whispered with a wink. Lola took the sweet and giggled. She felt safe with Juana. One evening, a few days after that conversation, Doña Antonia instructed Juana to give Lola her supper and put her to bed early. Lola fell asleep almost immediately, but suddenly awakened in the middle of the night. She looked around. Something was off. A luminescent moon cast a diffused glow over the room. Why wasn't the window shuttered beneath the gauzy curtains? Shadows flickered on the dimly lit wall. The silhouette of a person seemed to form and then dissolve. Lola trembled. Her eyes darted around the room. She saw the armoire, the dresser, the shelf for her dolls and toys. She saw the crucifix above her bed, a small table and chairs where she often took her meals, and the cabinet where the Victrola sat. Everything was in place. The statue of the Virgin stood white and ethereal on the nightstand. But where was Juana? She wasn't on the cot by Lola's bed where she usually slept. Lola began to whimper. Juana? Shh. Juana stepped out from the alcove, fully dressed, a frayed rebozo thrown over her shoulders. She was carrying a candle. Its glimmer made the shadows on the wall dance and twist like ragdolls.
Juana, I'm scared, whispered Lola. I think I heard a noise.
No, you didn't. Go back to sleep. Another shadow appeared on the wall. Lola squinted hard. It wasn't on the wall at all. It was a man standing in front of the wall. Lola couldn't see his features, but she was sure this form was solid. The man took a step toward her. Lola screamed. Juana raised her hand and slapped the child across the face. Shut up, she snapped. Lola couldn't believe the sting on her cheek, and she couldn't believe the hatred in Juana's voice or the cruelty in her eyes. Lola opened her mouth to say something, but Juana raised her hand again, and the words stuck in her throat. A warm, sticky wetness oozed out of her body, covering her thighs and bottom, and then trickled down her leg. She had to scream. She had to call Papa, but she was paralyzed. Juana said something to the man in a language that wasn't Spanish, Lola didn't understand it, but she knew it was a dialect of Nahuatl. Juana sometimes spoke it with the other maids or at the marketplace. Lola knew what was going to happen next. The man was going to grab her by the hair, and Juana was going to hold her down. Then they would slit her throat. They would place her head on the pillow soaked with blood, and Mommy would find her dead in the morning, just as Pablito's mother had found him. Once again, Lola opened her mouth to scream, but before she could hurl a blood-curdling shriek to wake up her parents, she felt something warm.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.